Well, good afternoon. Thank you for being here today. It's a beautiful day and certainly many things you could be involved with, but thank you for being present today to celebrate Esther's life, Jess's life. If you've never sat in the front row of one of these services, then you don't know how much it is appreciated that you're here to support all of the family. So thank you for being here today. It's a privilege for me to be a part of this time. Thank you for the honor. And the family would like to have you all participate today. So a little bit later in our gathering, after you watch a video of Jess's life, there'll be an opportunity for you to share a thought, a memory. And that adds so much to this time, so I hope you will consider that. Let's pray together as we begin. Father, we do thank you for this time. A time to remember, a time to celebrate, and no doubt, Lord, a time of great emotion. And yet, we thank you for Jess's life, a life that would be lived so that people would come and remember and celebrate her, and we would ask you to bless this time, bring your comfort and your peace, and may we even sense your presence. We pray all of this because of Jesus. Amen. So I have the privilege of sharing a little bit of Jess's life, many things that you know, but I'll share just a little bit and then Steve will come and share a little bit more. Esther Pauline Schoen was born January 11th, 1926 in Minnewaukan. Did I get that right? North Dakota, all right. Her parents were Herman and Louise Schoen. Esther was the oldest of five. Dad was a farmer. And no doubt Esther learned how to work hard in her early years. The oldest child, no doubt taking care of the younger ones and helping mom and dad get by in those days. As a child, the family moved to Idaho, where Esther attended school and graduated from Rupert High School. And shortly after graduation, she moved to the big city, to Portland, Oregon, to begin her nursing training. But somebody spotted her in Portland. As the story goes, a young man named Ben Annabo saw a good-looking young lady walking across the street in Portland. He began his pursuit. That good-looking young lady, understand, was Esther, and what a beautiful photo of her there on the screens. Striking. So Ben pursued her until Esther caught him, and they were married on August 1st, 1947. Esther completed her nursing degree, pursued her career working for 25 years at Eastmoreland Hospital in the OB department. Ben and Esther were blessed with four children, Chris, Steve, and Carla, and Carrie here. So now she had a very full life, nursing, being a full-time mom, supporting Ben in his business. She was a wonderful mom. I just enjoyed the brief time I had with the children to understand just her commitment to them, and not just to them, but many people, as I understand, found a place at her table and a place to stay. She had a big heart, a strong disposition. She was a faithful wife to Ben and was married to Ben for close to 30 years before his death in 1974. After Ben's death, Esther continued to invest her life in her children, and then her 10 grandchildren, and her four great-grandchildren. 88 years, a lot of life packed into 88 years, and you're all part of that. And so we don't want to make the mistake of thinking that somehow we're going to capture her life in the few moments we have here, but to celebrate it, because certainly she will be missed by all of us, by her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So with that in mind, I'm going to invite her son Steve to come and share some thoughts.
You're going to have to hold. Use the restroom?
No, you can't use the restroom.
Well, thank you guys, everybody, for coming here today. I see a lot of sad faces. And, you know, Mom left a big void in our hearts, all the memories and so forth. But we've got nothing to be sad about. You know, she went home to be with the Lord, where we're all going to hopefully go, and reuniting with Dad. And that's what we have that hope. So, yeah, Mom was, she was special. You know, came into Dad's life and kind of fanned the flame. He was a special man himself, and Mom supported him just like every wonderful, lucky husband has. And the times I got to spend with Mom, because, you know, I've been single for a while, but just with her, I could see what a lucky man my dad was, because Mom just kind of went along with stuff. She'd support it, and it seemed like whatever you did, she would enjoy it. And that was just the way Mom rolled. She was, you know, she wasn't so much like a domineering leader. She just kind of went along with whatever happened. So I know a lot of you guys we've spent time together up at the house up on Mount Scott, and we've spent a lot of time at your homes too. But the things that stick out in our minds was that when we were kids, you know, our mom just kind of seemed to have everything under control. We were pretty active kids, and my dad was busy with, you know, businesses, like we all, you know, trying to figure out where to make a buck. And so, you know, it seemed like Mom just made it happen. Somehow it didn't seem like she was always slaving or, you know, going, it just got done. And I know that, you know, she would kind of let us know what needed to be done. And me being the only boy, I was fortunate to have three sisters that would kind of gang up on me and make sure I did my share. But of course, that's the advantage I have of being up here with the mic. So you don't want to hear their side. But I was very blessed with three sisters, and I know our parents were very proud of us. You know, there was good and bad. I mean, our parents loved us beyond measure, and we're very, very blessed. But you know, the whole childhood thing, when my parents, they would get together with other families with kids. So, you know, it was like us kids would get to have the run of whatever, and they made sure we had fun things to do. And the parents were having their fun times, you know, with them. It was just always a positive, wonderful thing. And we've all got all those memories to look back on. And, you know, we were blessed to have them, because that sets a standard, you know, and we've got to, you know, realize there's a lot of things in life that can make, you know, give us negative feelings and things that are going on. We can always kind of look down, but don't dwell on that, you know. Dwell on the blessings we have. And some of them are memories, and some of them are wonderful things to yet to come. So let's be thinking about that. So anyhow, my dad, you know, when his kind of untimely death, Mom was only 48, and she kind of joined in with us kids. And she had a great place on Mount Scott, so, you know, we used it as kind of the party central. Mom was always right there and with us. She was one of the girls. And, I mean, she could hold her own. Yeah. But she was always just positive, making sure, you know, everybody had what we needed, have a good time, and, you know, we lived through it. So, yeah, very, very fortunate. I had notes to write, say stuff, but I'm going to have to wing it here at this point. So, you know, like Mom, you know, she was a hardworking, you know, dedicated employee. And us kids were pretty much, you know, able to do as we wanted around the house. They would let us know what they wanted done when they got home. And who knows what we could get into. You know, I had my guy friends, they had their girlfriends, and the house was, you know, just a wonderful place to hang out. We had horses and motorcycles and, you know, go-karts, and we all had, you know, pretty much blessed life. So, the parents were providers, so in that respect, you know, we couldn't ask for anything better. Now, I was going to call my sister Carla and Carrie up here, too. But we've got a few adventures, and unless they, you know, give me the sign. I'm going to just tell a couple. See, like, Mom, when my dad was busy at business and getting things going, she'd want to visit her family in Idaho. So she'd round up all of his kids, get everything packed. And, I mean, Mom was a folder ironer, the whole bit, get us all ready to go. And off we'd go. Well, one time, we had a little 50-something Hillman Minx, a little mini car. And in those days, they were like, you know, three-cylinder, two-cylinder, I don't know. But it had, you know, I remember the turn signals had a little arm that went out. It didn't even have the lights. Honestly, a little reflector. Yeah, it, but she was going to go visit her family in Rupert, Idaho. So us four kids packed in the back of that Hillman Minx because one of her cousins from who knows, somebody we didn't really know, had more or less invited herself to go with us on our vacation. So it was my mom taking the kids, and then Maxine was on the passenger side. And so, I mean, bless her heart. Maxine was, you know, very heavy, and there were sometimes she had to get out and help us, kind of, you know, so we could make it up certain hills. I remember that. I mean, this is a little Hillman Minx. I mean, it was working its little guts out with all of us. But anyhow, we made it to Idaho, and, you know, so I'm picturing Mom dealing with all this. And then there was another episode where this, well, the family would go over there occasionally. That was kind of our big, you know, vacation time. So we were going to go over to visit her parents and her mother, I should say. Her dad died earlier. But us four kids in the back seat, Christy, Carla, Carrie, and I. And I was addicted to pickled Polish sausage. And I saved up my lawnmower money to buy a whole jar for this vacation. So, of course, we're on the road, and the kids are all, you know, watering mouth and wanting one, and I'd let them have a bite of one if I could slug them in the arm. You know. Yeah, real macho. But anyhow, of course, to hear them tell it, you know, they were probably, you know. And then even on the way home, of course, the Polish sausages were gone, but I'd get to slug him for a sip of the juice. You know, you pour a little in the lid. And, yeah. But one time, my parents, you know, it was a long drive to Idaho, maybe an 8-hour drive or whatever, and we take off in the afternoon, it seemed like always at night. And so us kids are bored in the back seat, excited. And so we started taking our clothes out of the, you know, the suitcases and stuff, and tying their strings, you know, drawstrings and, you know, stuff together, and then letting it dangle out the back of the station wagon. And we tie another one, giggling, laughing, and Mom's probably asleep, and Dad's driving, and we got all these clothes just dangling back. We're laughing, having a blast, getting more excited as it went until somebody let go. And there went our clothes. We couldn't say anything because we knew we'd get in trouble. So we get to Idaho, and, oh, I don't know, Mom had to deal with that. Us kids were always offering help, right? So, but, you know, just those exciting things that, you know, Mom just seemed to make happen. She was, you know, just a wonderful friend of all of our friends, because the husband and wife would be together with Mom and Dad, and we'd be with the kids. But it just seemed like Mom supported anything Dad did. He'd get involved. One time we were at a county fair, family, and who knows how Dad met one of the people at the fair. And this person happened to be a midget and must have been homeless or something. So George Query, one of our dear friends of the family, happened to be over on a weekend visiting with Dad. And out of the basement stairs, up comes this door, and this midget comes out of the basement. And to hear George just laugh and tell the story, he just couldn't believe what he saw. But that's how Dad was. You know, he'd just, you know, help out anybody he could possibly, you know, anybody came along. And passed it on to us kids, because any of our friends that needed a place to stay, we had many of them crashing at our place for, you know, lengths of time. It was, and but my mom, I mean, she had her door open. The place was always available. It was like a beehive. Mom was the queen bee, and we all just came and enjoyed her wonderful honey. So, anyway, thank you guys so much for coming. We're going to have a great day, and later on I'm going to join over at one of my sister's houses and just have a good party and some laughs. And God bless you guys. I know Mom's home with the Lord, and she used to come to church with me, and you know, that was something we really enjoyed together. And so I'm hoping you guys are stick connected with the Lord. I think it's more important as these times are going on. So I just encourage everybody to just take that look at, you know, who God is, what he's done, and he's available, every one of us. And all we have to do is ask him, and he'll answer. He's in our heart. If we ask him into our heart, he's there. So I wanted to say that for Mom. And thank you very much, you guys.
You. have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in the words how wonderful life is while you're in the world.
You said I was in my early 40s with a lot of life before me. When a moment came that stopped me on a dime, I spent most of the next days looking at the x-rays, talking about the options, and talking about sweet time. I asked him when it sank in that this might really be the real end. How's it hit you when you get that kind of news? Man, what'd you do? And he said, I went skydiving, I went Rocky Mountain climbing, I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Blue Manchu, and I looked deeper, and I spoke sweeter, and I gave forgiveness I've been denying. And he said, someday I hope chance to live like you were dying.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I
those first photos there in North Dakota, that was looked like quite a grueling existence there, didn't it? And who is the guy running the rototiller? Who was that?
Gary Griggs.
Yeah. Good memories. I love those photos that just capture that. And So we'd like to open it up. The family would love to hear comments, or even any of the family would like to share just a thought or a memory. And you don't need to come up here. I can bring the microphone down, or you can just talk really loud so everybody can hear. We'd like to have a few people share before we begin to wrap things up. Who would like to start? Right over there. All right. Right over here. Go ahead. All right. Give it a try.
My name's Wayne Swanson. I live right across the street from Jesse. When she first moved in there, I went over to introduce myself. And she said, "Do you have a parrot?" And I said, "No. Does anybody in the neighborhood have a parrot?" I said, "I don't think so. She just recently moved in." Well, what it was, next door to me is the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Every morning at 9 o'clock, the ladies have their aerobics class. And they leave the door open. And believe it or not, it sounds just like a parrot's. Jesse was a great neighbor and a good friend.
Okay, I'm going to probably fall apart, but it's all good. Anyhow, I've been in this Klan for almost 40 years. I think the title they put on that is Survivor. And you know what I'm saying.
Call him Die Hard.
Right. Couple little quick things. My mother-in-law, about 39 years ago, bought me a little saber saw, a little wooden saw. She saw that I had an inclination to want to do woodwork and stuff. And the reason that I'm glad you didn't let me get up there is because that led to a 40-year career in woodwork. Now, if I get behind a pulpit, if she gets me up there, who knows, right? One of my little favorite stories is, and she was always notorious for a little bit of a late arrival, just a little bit. On our wedding day, October 5th, 1974, 39 years, I got it. Anyway, so we were at my grandma's house, which was across from the church where I had been raised, the church we had gone to. And the wedding was at 2 o'clock, in theory. And my mother-in-law, and so we have picture photo proof of this, in conjunction with the gentleman that had my tuxedo. There's a picture of my mother-in-law in this beautiful white and blue striped gown, leaning over the little peninsula counter in the kitchen, just gorgeous. And the clock behind her says 2:05. Yeah, okay, not a problem. Anyway, but it was forgivable because after the wedding, and if you know Steve, only Steve could do this, she had a little orange opal, and so you were driving your mom, and we were over by Lewis and Clark College was the church, and we're going to Jess's Hilltop House, which is up on Mount Scott, 92nd. We didn't stop at one stoplight, and I'm talking about a caravan. Steve would rip right up to the light, get out of his car and stop traffic. He was going like this. And we were just like, okay. So that made it forgivable. I had another little quick one. Oh, here's another little quick one. Bless her heart, she was so sweet. One of the little stories is she had some goats. I don't know what that was. I've been finally blessed. Thank you. She had gotten hold of a goat out in the pear orchard, right? Mm-hmm. And her bedroom was right near that west side of the house. And she had told the story that one night she woke up and she was just hearing somebody calling her name. Really kind of made her feel a little weird and frantic. And then she kept hearing this, "Jess. Jess." and finally opened the window and it was the goat. Jess. Anyhow. I've been around this family so long, and I know too many stories, but I embrace everything about this whole crew, my beautiful nieces, nephews, some that aren't even here. And this gentleman I want to identify, this is Eugene Rogers. He has been the surrogate grandfather for all of our kids. The step-up guy, and we love you. We love you.
Love you guys, too.
Forgive me. Let me get my head together here. Anyway, my mother-in-law, I could not have been more blessed than to have this woman. Any of you know that know her. I cherish that in my walk on this earth, that I could have her. I got three main ladies in my life. My wife, my mother, who's in the rare joy, my daughter, and my mother-in-law. And I mean, I got it all, you know. But anyway, she was my friend, someone I could talk to on any level, political, spiritual. I partied with her. I danced with her. She was one of the all-around gals for me. And I'm glad that I got to pass through this place, this time, before an eternity, and that she was on that path with me. So, very blessed. And I got her out of the deal, and I got my son Eli and my daughter. Got it all. Thank you.
Thank you. Somebody right back here.
I have two stories to tell about Jess. When Rhonda's dad passed away, Jess and the girls came to visit and to be at the funeral. And it was in December. And we're at the house there in Caldwell, and saw some pictures of it up here. And they get up middle of the night, and of course, Art and Susie don't smoke, and so they decide the girls and Jess are gonna go outside, have a smoke. Happens to be, what, about midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning. They close the door. It locks. It's 10 degrees below zero outside and 12 inches of snow. And they're going, oh no. Because they're not wearing coats either. So, how do we get into the house? They tiptoe around back through the snow, and Jess gets up to the window. Tap, 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 tap. Susie! Tap, 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 tap. Susie! Tap, tap, tap. Susie, we locked ourselves out. Let us in! Pretty soon, Susie wakes up. Susie's only 5 feet tall, by the way. Looking out the window. What are you doing out there? Let us in. So she lets him in. Nobody slept for the next, what, hour and a half, 2 hours? My wife and I were there. We were all laughing and having a good time. It to be a part of the Annabelle clan was interesting, to say the least. I understand. I do understand. And to be a little tardy was an understatement. You're not the only ones that experienced the Annabelle clock. The other one was funny. You know, we brought my mother-in-law, Susie, up, and we were going deep sea fishing. And we're going out to Garibaldi to go fishing. And we stop and see Jess. She's living on the golf course, and we spend the night there with Jess, but we go over to the golf course clubhouse to have dinner. And so we sit down to dinner. And my wife and I are there sitting, and Jess and Susie are there sitting. And Susie's 90 years old. Jess is about 82 years old. And there's two gentlemen at the next table over. And we're eating, and pretty soon you hear comments over there. Sure like that silver hair. Oh, good-looking silver hair. And the two ladies are continuing eating. And pretty soon one of them leans over and says, "You two ladies play golf?" Jess says, "Yeah, we've hit a few around. Interested in going out for a game tomorrow?" Susie looks at him and says, "Oh, maybe. How about dinner afterwards?" "Well, going fishing." "Oh. But okay anyway, guys." And then we finished dinner, went out the door. I look at him and go, "You know you two were getting hit on, or was it you hitting on them?" They're going, "Ladies don't tell such things." Okay. Well, anyway, that's how the whole evening went, and we were teasing them about, you know, you need to set a good example for the younger generation. Jess looks at me and says, "I think I was." So that was the fun and the bantering, and 82, they were still having a good time. So that was some of the positive being a member of the family. Pretty cool.
I'm Dean Hannibal. Susie was my aunt. I was the son of Ozzy. I got two things. One of them, that ship reminded me they had up there. After Ben died, Susie took a cruise, but she was a nurse on the cruise, so they paid her for the cruise. And I don't know how many cruises she took. Several, okay. But I thought that was very, very interesting. The best memory I have was, I live up in Silverdale. I have a little Christmas tree farm, and Jess and my mom came to visit, and so I was going to show them the tree farm. And well, you can't just show them the tree and leave, you know. You had to show them how to shear, and then to make them feel more comfortable, I needed to give them a job. Something, well, could you count the trees in this patch? Well, there's about 500 trees now. Trees aren't like cattle and sheep. They don't move. I didn't realize how much entertainment that was. It took them, they spent 4 or 5 hours. No, not quite. They couldn't come up with the same number. They couldn't agree. And it was very interesting, but a very pleasant moment of and fun time we had. So we're going to miss Jess.
I just have to say one about when Dennis was talking about weddings. And when Chris and Rufus got married, they got married at the Hilltop House. And they gave their wedding rings to Jess for safekeeping. You remember? How many years did it take her to find the ring? Yeah. They were married so many years before Jess found the ring that she'd hidden in a shoebox in this. Unbelievable. Then I have to tell about the Hilltop House and the parties and the Enobos. Whenever I'd bring a friend and they'd meet my family, they'd say, "Enobos are different. Your family is a different family. They like each other. They get along." And it's true. Ben and Jess, they loved unconditionally. They accepted everybody. They never judged people. They never put people down. And it's just good when somebody goes to the, you know, be with their other loved ones, which is another thing I saw on the 4th of July. Jess died at 12:23. And I woke up at 2:10, and I felt the need to pray for Jess. And it was shortly after that I saw Uncle Ben holding his hands out like this, and he said, "S." And Uncle Ben used to call Jess S because her name was Esther. And I was just asking my daughter on the way, I said, "Is her name really Jess?" Because Jennifer said, "Is it Esther Jessica?" And I didn't know. But then Carrie told me that, yeah, she, because Ben called her S. So, but people would always ask, you know, you Annabos, do you, you have an accent? You all go, oh, you know, every, oh, and Chris was notorious for that, and the long hug. So, anyway, they're missed and loved, but in a better place.
Thank you. We'll have one more here. All right.
All right. First time you get to go to a party at the Annabos Hilltop House. Jess opens the door, loud music, every kind of music that you know because the albums are lining the wall. You remember that room? Mm-hmm. Then you get the sign on the wall. All those walls, is everybody's name on there? Big difference. And those doggone clove cigarettes?
One more thought, Steve. Go ahead.
I want to thank everybody for putting up with our reminiscing, and I know we're going to have a million stories to tell. I have a very, very special treat for everybody today, and you guys, your hearts are going to be warmed, and you're going to have chills. I'd like to introduce Megan and Maddie. They want to sing a special tribute for Annie. Or for Grandma Mimi.
Nice.
We will be singing When I Was Your Man by Bruno Mars. Same bed, but it feels just a little bit bigger now. Our song on the radio, but it don't sound the same. When our friends talk about you, all it does is just tear me down. 'Cause my heart breaks a little when I hear your name. It all just sounds like ooh, ooh, ooh. Too young, too dumb to realize that I should have bought you flowers and held your hand. Should have given you all my hours when I had the chance. Take you to every party, 'cause all you wanted to do was dance. Now my baby's dancing, but she's dancing with another man. My pride, my ego, my needs, and my selfish ways caused a good, strong woman like you to walk out my life. Now I never get to clean up the mess I made. No. And it haunts me every time I close my eyes. It all just sounds like ooh, ooh, ooh. Too young, too dumb to realize that I should have bought you flowers and held your hand. Should have gave you all my hours when I had the chance. Take you to every party, 'cause all you wanted to do was dance. Now my baby's dancing, but she's dancing with another man. Although it hurts, I'll be the first to say I was wrong. Oh, I know I'm probably much too late to try and apologize for my mistakes, but I just want you to know I hope he buys you flowers. I hope he holds your hand, gives you all his hours when he has the chance. Takes you to every party, 'cause I remember how much you love to dance. To all the things that I should have done when I was your man. To all the things that I should have done when I was your man.
That was amazing. Well, we'll bring our time to a close here. This has been a wonderful time, a privilege for me to be a part of the Annabos clan just for a little bit and hear the stories, and no doubt I get that sense that all those stories will continue, which is a very good thing. So it's been good to be able to share about Jess's life. And just as we wrap this up, you know, the other thing that's really good about moments like this, it's really one of the few times that we stop in life and consider our mortality, that we die. So that's good, because we rush through life, you know, and you'll have your time afterwards, as we all do, and then we go on and we just get back into the busyness, and we don't stop to think that it does stop eventually. So it's good to reflect on that, and there's a portion of Scripture that reminds us that that there is indeed something beyond this life, and that Jesus is that bridge that allows us to experience the fullness beyond. So it's the 23rd Psalm. We'll just close by reading it. Many of you are familiar with the 23rd Psalm. It speaks of the Lord in very beautiful ways as He is. So may those words of Scripture bring comfort even as we close. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Father God, we thank You for this time, and we thank You for the reminder of Scripture that You are indeed a good God, and can be a very personal God as we call out to You. So, Father, I would pray that the words of Scripture would bring comfort to the family today, that the memories that they share would continue to give them joy in the days ahead. And, Lord, even as they spend time together, just being together as family and friends, that, Lord, Your presence and Your peace would rest upon them. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So some refreshments have been provided right through this door in the fireside room. Some cookies and juice and coffee and punch. And then following that time, everybody's invited up to Dennis and Carrie's home. If you don't know where that's at, they'll give you directions, all right? So God bless you as you go. Thank you.